Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lost in Thought, The Hidden Pleasures of an Intellectual Life by Zena Hitz, narrated by Emily Ellet. Prologue. How washing dishes restored my intellectual life. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all that you may desire cannot compare with her. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 11. Midway through the journey of my life, I found myself in the woods of eastern Ontario, living in a remote Catholic religious community called Madonna House. We lived by a river that froze into flat, icy landscapes in the winter, giving off mist as it thawed and froze again. In summer, the water warmed to allow swimming or boat trips through thick weeds up into the wild and empty vistas of the river valley. Our manner of life was rustic, as poor as it was hidden, thanks to the community's deliberate commitment to poverty. We slept in dormitories, used water sparingly, wore donated clothing, and ate vegetables either in the short growing season or as the root cellar or the freezer permitted. The work varied and was assigned under obedience. I was the baker for a time, stewarding the capricious yeast and the fire of the oven, emerging at the end of the day covered in dough, flour, and ash. I then worked in the handicrafts department, restoring furniture, repairing books, organizing materials, decorating for holidays. I joked that I was being trained as a 19th century housewife. Next, I was assigned to the library. Then to a long stint cleaning and researching donated antiques for the community's gift shop. I shared in the common work of house cleaning and washing dishes, as well as planting, weeding, and harvesting vegetables. As in many such communities, we switched jobs often enough that no one could be fully identified with their work. This made it easier to see work not as a vehicle for achievement, but as a form of service. Talent and interest were valuable, but ultimately irrelevant. Certainly, neither any of these jobs, nor the basic approach to life, was what I had spent the previous 20 years preparing for. From the age of 17 until I left for Canada at the age of 38, I had been dedicated full-time to institutions of higher learning, first as a student, and then as a professor and a scholar of classical philosophy. My life as a professional intellectual had its roots in my childhood. From my earliest memory, I lived with books of all kinds. There were stacks on my bedroom floor, and they lined the dusty walls of our Victorian house. My older brother taught me to read and infected me with an appetite for reading. My parents were both lovers of books, words, and ideas without professional training or support, amateurs in the original and best sense. San Francisco in the 1970s was a strange place for many famous reasons, but its basic commitment to leisure is clear to me only now that we have passed into a far less leisurely age. Reading and thinking for their own sake went along with outings to the stony beaches or dark mountain forests of Northern California, without a clear object or specialized skills or expensive equipment. The standard for success of an activity was enjoying oneself in fellowship with others. Such endeavors included the arts and crafts projects that no one would ever buy, and musical performances whose value would evaporate at too great a distance from the campfire. That natural foods were superior to processed ones was a hard fact to swallow. I needed threats and wheedling to be induced to consume carob or brewer's yeast or foul-tasting medicinal tea. But I required no convincing to find that learning was a joy. My family was fond of fierce arguments over matters of fact, where no one present knew what they were talking about. World records and body counts, the proper classification of living things, and the nature of a lunar eclipse. The dictionary, the encyclopedia, and the almanac were the final reference points by which the arguments were settled. These resolutions were never entirely satisfactory. In the reference books, we found ammunition for yet further discussion and argument. Not one piece of knowledge that we sought or acquired was useful for any purpose whatsoever. My brother and I pursued obsessions with wild animals, especially sea creatures. We knew all 17 species of penguin and the feeding habits of whales. Large, blubbery sea lions sometimes surfaced at the local seashore. Otherwise, we relied on books or visits to the local science museum, studying our beloved objects through whale skeletons or at the thick-glassed dolphin tank that replayed recorded dolphin sounds when we pressed a button at the side. We amassed a vast collection of stuffed animals, who formed a political community and elected a small walrus as president. We established a constitution for them, wrote civic anthems, and of course, told stories. We imagined our way into the lives of animals, fusing animal and human capacities, as children have always done. Larger questions lurked unexpressed behind our sea of facts and our playful imagining. What is a human being? Is it enough to see, feel, eat, swim, squeak? Are we a part of nature or somehow outside of nature? My father and I once discussed that question, sitting on a rock in a mountain stream on a camping trip in the shade of clustered redwoods. It seemed unimaginable that we were like the forest, running water, or rock around us. Somehow, a human being stands outside of the natural. And yet, even a child knows that the time will come when breath is gone and all is overcome by weight, resistance, decay, and fermentation, our flesh traveling through the gullets of animals to become dirt and slime and dust. My family did not undertake intellectual practices and concerns as a means to an end. They did not consider them to be preparation for life, but rather a way of spending one's time that had its worth in itself. Accordingly, they did not blink when I left home to study old books and fundamental human questions at a tiny liberal arts college on the East Coast, a secular school under the improbable religious name of St. John's College. My parents did not ask me what use I would find the study of epic poems or ancient treatises on plants, whether it would help me to find my way in the world. Not that my choice was foreordained. My brother, for instance, pursued specialized training in biochemistry. But I needed neither prodding nor reassurance to study the liberal arts. The value of such an education, as one path among others, was simply obvious to us. The first phase of my academic life began in spectacular growth and excitement. I loved my little college at first sight, the willows at the water's edge, the green lawn sloping down to them, suited for summer rolling and winter sledding, the colonial red brick buildings that both charmed and startled me, fresh as I was from brick-free earthquake country. I was instantly at ease in the bare-bones classrooms, each furnished with only a large wooden table, old-fashioned caned chairs, and wraparound blackboards. Our classes proceeded without agendas, the discussion driven by the living questions that we and our teachers brought to the room. Accordingly, our conversations could flounder in indifference or lack of preparation. They could chug along steadily, building quiet momentum, or they could explode with the excitement of a newly discovered insight. I was enchanted by the honesty of the project. As the books were, as the questions were, as the human beings who participated were, so the discussion went. There was no artificial clarity or forced organization to soften the discomfort of the work of the mind, no cushion between us and the difficulties or dangers of inquiry or the thrill of discovery. Our seminars met in the evening and spilled over into discussion on the steps, on the quad, at the bar. A formal lecture on Friday evenings was followed by a question period of indefinite length, in which a good topic and a lively conversation might lead us past midnight and into the early morning, leaving the speaker an exhausted wreck, but the students fired up for more. These nocturnal practices continue today, but I speak in the past when I first encountered them. We all assumed that books mattered for life, but we knew so little about life that our earnest musings must have sounded ridiculous to any mature ear. Every book was connected with every other. The slightest technical detail in grammar or geometry was full of romance and significance that it would be gauche to articulate clearly. We loved the feeling of insight, but were inexperienced in the thing itself. Still, as if to will our maturity into being, our teachers spoke to us as if our ideas mattered, and so treated us as free adults, capable of making significant choices and coming to our own decisions about the hardest questions. In mathematics and science, our forms of inquiry were especially unconventional and exciting. We studied what mathematicians and scientists wrote and tried out what they practiced or experimented. We then saw scientific and mathematical thinking as a human endeavor, rather than a body of established facts to be memorized or a prefabricated skill that had been determined as necessary by nameless and faceless authorities. Mathematical and scientific skills, it turns out, are developed as means to ends, as routes to understanding, solutions to practical problems, or vehicles of contemplation, and they are as various as forms of play or styles of fine art. The established facts were neither. They were boiled down versions of tentative truths that would be partly preserved, partly destroyed in the next generation of theory. I blossomed in the simplicity and spontaneity of life at the college. The exclusive focus on reading and conversation, the insistence on asking basic human questions, the conviction that the value of intellectual activity lay in the search more than the achievement. I remember writing an essay on Oedipus Rex as a freshman and being overwhelmed with the delight of discovering new, to me, insights. I walked about in the pale green of spring trees in rapt distraction, thinking about things. And I knew that somehow I had found an essential piece of my future life. After graduation, many of my classmates took their supposedly useless liberal arts education out of the ivory tower and into the realms of politics, law, business, journalism, and nonprofit initiatives. They founded schools and peopled law firms, corporate boards, the New York Times, international non-governmental organizations, and high reaches of the U.S. government. They found, in other words, that study for its own sake, that is, study without visible results or high-prestige credentials, was enormously useful for other ends. I ended up, through a series of lucky breaks, in the world of elite academia, where, after some initial struggle, I too was very successful. But my eventual success planted the seeds for long years of gradual and crushing disillusionment with academic life. At first, graduate school was also tremendously exciting. I learned the ancient professional trades that underlie the great books and their confrontation with human questions: scholarship, commentary, and interpretation. By custom, my colleagues in classical philosophy, faculty and graduate students, gathered into informal reading groups whenever we found ourselves in sufficient numbers. As we sat around a table with an ancient text in front of us, sharing our puzzles with one another and tossing out ideas, I found the intellectual honesty and spontaneity of my undergraduate years while seeing further into the depths and the details. I developed a love for the intricacies of Greek grammar. I found my way into library work, still one of my greatest pleasures. I chased sources, references, and associations through the fluorescent-lit labyrinths of the stacks, stumbling into strange corners, certain to discover something either illuminating or hilarious or both. I learned the delightful mental gymnastics of analytic philosophy, in which any manner of thesis whatsoever is defended, explored, and almost always refuted. I understood that our scattered communities of scholars and teachers were part of a grand, international, and trans-historical project for the preservation and transmission of learning. I learned over time, first as a graduate student and then as a young professor, that the amateur's human questions are always the best questions for scholars to start from. I also began a different kind of training in graduate school, bound by invisible but powerful threads to the first sort. From the casual conversation of my teachers and fellow students, I learned how to navigate the Byzantine social hierarchy of the academic world. I learned whom to admire and whom to disdain. To be told who was out made one feel included in the in. But of course, the ruthlessness and ubiquity of the practice of judgment suggested how fragile my own limited success was. Through hearing scorn pronounced on academic failure and rejection, and through pronouncing it myself, I developed a terror of being judged wanting by my teachers and my peers. Like many graduate students, I learned to obsessively scan the behavior of others for signs of increased or lost favor. Like virtually all of them, I was convinced that I alone was in danger of failure, and everyone else was sailing through with perfect confidence. The fear of failure had a flip side, of course, an intense desire to succeed at the game of prestige, to prove myself as good as some and better than others. I had a very vivid and strange dream early on in graduate school, a dream unlike any I've had before or since. I dreamed that one of my teachers, whom I admired very much and on whose approval I depended, was leading a seminar on the topic of niceness, dressed in his academic gown. The dream world has its peculiarities. The seminar took place in my high school gym, with the addition of a grand escalator. In the dream, I asked him why he cared about being nice, given his stratospheric academic prestige. He turned to me in horror, took me by the arm, led me out of the room, and questioned me as to what I meant. When I repeated myself, he said to me with great emphasis, "I care about niceness, I do very much. I want to be loved, adored." His voice dropped to a dramatic whisper. "Worshipped." The dream was, of course, very amusing to me and to my fellow students, to whom I immediately related it. But it contained a fundamental insight that my conscious life could not bear, an insight perhaps into my teacher in particular, but more certainly into the values of academic life in general, at least in some departments, and at least as I lived it. To say we sought status and approval sounds more bloodless than it was. We wanted it at the expense of others. We observed and cultivated, for instance, the thrill of the critical academic takedown, a ritual act of humiliation that usually took place in public, a cutting book review, a devastating objection from the back of the lecture hall. These were a currency of success, not despite, but because of their cruelty. We viewed such events with awe, as if to tacitly recognize their inhuman character. Our embrace of public acts of competitive humiliation mixed in a sickly way with our perception of the real loftiness of learning. The victors in these gladiatorial contests thus took on a certain grandeur that inspired fascination and idolatry. And this idolatry, elsewhere recognized as celebrity, was what we wanted for ourselves. That was simply what mattered to us. Or rather, to those of us like myself, who lacked a sufficient inner core of humanity to defend against it. It must be said that I threw myself into brutal competition for status and prestige without much thought and with few conscious misgivings. I lacked, at first, the professional skills and habits I needed to move comfortably, but before long, I was swimming like a fish in water, as much at home in the gossip sea as in the library stacks. It helped that the waters were not always easy to tell apart. Our energetic expressions of superiority might mix seamlessly with a philosophical conversation that lasted until sunrise. We went home, slept, and took it up again. It took a number of years before the invisible thread in me that bound the drama of reputation to the steady, serious process of real learning began to become undone, unwinding the rest of my life along with it. By 2001, I had been a graduate student for 5 years at 3 different universities. I took a master's at the first and transferred from the second. By then, the initial struggles and shocks were far behind, and I was luxuriating in academic success, in an environment bursting with intellectual life and with friends with whom any conversation was possible. The twin plants of intellectual joy and of achievement in prestige and status had grown together so closely that, to me, their blossoming was indistinguishable, each from the other. One morning in September, I walked, as usual, onto campus via one of its tree-lined paths. As I walked, one of the department's staff called out something to me about a dramatic news story. and I stopped into the student center to look at a television. When I arrived, the live image of the World Trade Center, each tower in flames, was on the screen. I sat down and read the tickers from the bottom of the screen, trying to put the pieces together. A few minutes later, one of the towers collapsed into ash. The announcers on the news immediately lost their words. During a lab experiment in college, I was once accidentally exposed to a large charge of static electricity. It was as if everything stopped and started again, as if someone had hit my reset button, or as if I were an etch-a-sketch whose elaborate patterns had been suddenly shaken to a gray blank. The moment that the first tower collapsed was much like that. Everything in me stopped. Out of the shocked blankness came the insistent thought that I had to quit philosophy and do something to break out of the world of the library and into the world of action and international affairs, a world that I imagined in ignorance, knowing only slogans and catchphrases. The bombings immediately took on a national meaning, one that I drank in without thinking much on it. It was easy at that time to believe in the exceptional nature of the event, in the specialness of the victims, and so I did. But the nationalist impulse was a reduction of the real and perceptible effect of the events on me, an unconscious attempt to normalize and contain their unsettling and unearthly character. Along with the news-fueled sorrow came what was, for me, uncharacteristic kindness. I remember seeing someone drop some file folders on campus and rushing immediately to help, that person's need blotting out everything else. A trivial event, but somehow luminous to me. I was able to see during that time wounds on people's faces, broken, vulnerable looks. I found that I spoke more freely and openly to my friends and family, and they to me. The new forms of awareness and motivation stuck out in my mind. They puzzled me. I remember, as they faded, I found myself wishing that something else terrible would happen to renew the effect, and then, of course, recoiling at myself. It took some months for these uncharacteristically compassionate feelings and impulses to fade, and for my normal self-absorption to reassert itself. But the disenchantment with academic life lasted quite a bit longer. I sensed that I belonged to a broader community of human beings than the community of scholars. What was the point of studying philosophy and classics? What conceivable difference could it make in the face of the suffering world? It did not help that the academic world is famously and truly insular. Events and ideas from outside it enter through a narrow and peculiarly shaped gate, so that the experience of them always feels pre-digested. I longed for a broader experience, to gain my own traction over events in some way. My tentative explorations of alternate career paths, such as human rights work or politics, felt so uncomfortable that I knew they would not suit me. Lacking a clear way forward, I decided to press on with my academic career with a simple change of dissertation topic. My old project, an investigation into ancient views of self-knowledge, was now dry as dust to my eyes. I turned to a more relevant study of the ancient critiques of democracy. The crisis unresolved, there formed in me a wide, icy river of discontent that would surface for a time before disappearing back underground, where it gurgled along just below my awareness. What was it, really, that sparked my discontent? Was I suddenly dissatisfied with the life of the mind? Or had I caught a glimpse into the academic hall of mirrors that I had unthinkingly allowed to shape my thinking and feeling? Which of my intertwined paths was the selfish and narrow one? For a long time, I was sure that intellectual work was useful only as a form of influence on real events. But in the clarity of the backward glance, I can see that world savers and difference makers, especially those who work for large international institutions, are more highly regarded in our society than high prestige academics. So I could, for a time, imagine losing a life of books and ideas while gaining points in the social playbook. Of course, I did not see things that way at the time. It was the first of a series of unconscious bargains I struck with myself in the face of profound doubts about my way of living and being. In the short term, my crisis broke and blemished the smooth surface of my academic accomplishments. When I switched dissertation topics, I lost years of work and had to rush to try to catch up. My ability to speak in public became less reliable and lost its luster, my lack of confidence showing through the cracks. The path to success looked somewhat less automatic. A wrench was in the works. Still, at a moment when the academic job market was relatively stable, not long before the financial collapse that began in 2008, I found a tenure-track job at a large university in the South. After receiving my degree, I found myself in a new town full of strangers, at a university whose overweening passion for football was matched in no other sphere. The streets were wide, the traffic laissez-faire, the sunshine almost constant. Flowering trees and shrubs, dogwood, camellia, and azalea, gave parks and gardens an extravagant beauty, alongside vast stretches of asphalt parking lot, carelessly interspersed with shopping centers. The wound-up impatience I had nurtured in my long years on the East Coast found itself without outlet, and it collided constantly with the local climate of leisured contentment, as stubborn as it was slow. My job was simpler and less demanding of my time than the work of a graduate student had been. The unfilled hours stretched ahead of me each day, and boredom and loneliness filled the gaps like fog. In a kind of desperate restlessness, I went into the local community as a volunteer, tutoring in a literacy program, visiting the dying in hospices, working at a refugee resettlement center. This person-to-person service was like a slow drip of water on a dry sponge. A friendship developed between me and a factory worker in her 60s who had an eighth-grade education. She had no use for her studies, apart from a love and zeal for the structures of English grammar. She told me that she had sought out tutoring, as I had work as a tutor, out of loneliness and boredom. At the refugee center, the refugees themselves were kept behind thick windows, where they waited for checks or to talk to someone who could untangle their paperwork. I was assigned to organize files for receipts that were duplicated elsewhere, as pointless a task as any I have encountered, and yet I found a peace in it I could not explain. It was around this time that I rather casually decided that I should have a religion, having grown up without one. I had experimented for a few years with my ancestral religion, Judaism, but lacking either parents or a spouse who practiced, I found no natural entrance to its deepest paths. With some disappointment, I visited some mainline Christian churches, unconsciously moving down an invisible list of major denominations ranked by social status. One church featured a homily on football. Another was packed full of visibly wealthy people who showed no sign of spiritual fervor. Both felt like social clubs, a way to feel superior or to feel comfortable. This repelled me, despite, or perhaps because of, my basic interest in social superiority. I wanted something different, something new, without knowing what it was. One Sunday, I attended Mass at the local Catholic parish. The church was almost completely silent when I entered, and faint sunlight fell on the statues. In the pews around me, I saw people of all races and backgrounds, some with families, some alone, many on their knees in quiet prayer. It occurred to me that there was simply no reason for such a random collection of people to be in the same room. We were, each of us, there alone, and yet united in something invisible and beyond my reach. I decided immediately to begin the process of entering the Catholic Church. I attended the classes for converts at the parish, and in 2006, I was baptized at the long, grand liturgy that Catholics celebrate the night before Easter. At first, I did not connect my interest in having a religion with the existential crisis that I had lived with in some degree for 5 years. Shortly after my baptism, I moved back to the East, to a new teaching post in Baltimore. I was not there long before the evident poverty and suffering of the city began to unsettle once again my commitment to an academic career track. I visited churches in desolate parts of town, with broken glass in the streets and blocks of boarded-up windows. Unlike the poor neighborhoods deliberately cordoned off, made invisible in most large American cities, the desolation here stretched on and on, lurking behind every new development. In Baltimore, it was impossible to hide from the sight of poverty or its consequences. The suffering I had imagined previously as exotic, extraordinary, and most of all, elsewhere, seemed to have closed in around me. Under the new aspect of faith, the tensions in me seemed to stretch out to the bounds of the world and to pull at sharp hooks anchored in the depths of my inner life. I began to see that human suffering was not limited to special events, and that it could not be ended by reversing particular policies. There was no need to wait for disasters to strike. They were omnipresent, as was responsibility for them. Suffering was a cosmic force, an ever-present reality, Christ crucified at the heart of the world and suffusing it up to the edges. I tried to stop shifting the suffering of others out of view, as had been my constant habit. I began to seek it out, to force myself into regular contact with it. My frustration with my work, with the focus of my life, thus expanded both in breadth and depth. When I looked to the outside world, I saw tremendous suffering and disorder, to which I could make no discernible difference. Nearer by, the shallowness of my academic life became gradually more obvious. Either I sought approval or status by performing well at the expense of others, or in small groups, my fellow academics and I explained to one another our own superiority, our difference from the dumb, the wrong, the bad, and the ugly. I remember going to one academic dinner party among many, and suddenly feeling queasy as we suggested that the central values in our lives were fine wines and trips to Europe. I had by this point grown accustomed to being rewarded for my intellectual work with money, status, and privileges. Along the way, my focus had shifted, without my noticing, to the outcomes of my work rather than the work itself. I had lost much of the ability to think freely and openly on a topic, concerned lest I lose my hard-won position in the academic social hierarchy. I worked busily on narrow research projects and did not allow myself the time to read and reflect broadly. My colleagues and I went to exotic destinations as often as possible, seeking out prestigious experiences and high-end consumer goods as a serendipitous perk of participating in an international community of scholars. I visited Lisbon, London, and Berlin, operas, museums, and cabaret shows, and gobbled local delicacies. The tension contracted between these long-established pleasures and my attraction to the hidden world of suffering. By contrast, as my adventures in volunteering expanded, I met all manner of fascinating strangers who lived outside of middle-class conventions. I got to know a couple at the local Catholic worker house who had spent decades feeding and serving their neighbors in a particularly desolate neighborhood. Another couple spent their retirement living near a rural prison, hosting families who were visiting the inmates. I volunteered with a 4-foot-tall nun, tougher than nails, whose authority dissolved red tape at the women's jail, making possible the movement of ordinary forms of love, clothing, toiletries, conversation, and prayer. I met young men and women who had stepped off prestigious and boring career tracks to live among the poorest people they could find, supported by small donations. Other young people joined them, hungry for alternatives to self-satisfied middle-class life. I encountered by chance a lawyer at the Securities and Exchange Commission who began his work week by volunteering for the overnight shift at a hospice run by Mother Teresa's nuns. None of these people were much known or recognized. I found them by hard work, punctuated by lucky breaks rather than through publicity. They worked in hidden corners, invisible to any broader public. In all these adventures, I was still a college professor, lecturing to large classrooms on Plato, Aristotle, and contemporary ethics. The anonymous character of contemporary education for undergraduates clashed sharply with the person-to-person character of my volunteer work and the work of the unusual people that I met. In fact, I think it was in the classroom, in teaching, that I was in the end ground down the most. In exchange for my comfortable salary, excellent benefits, and ample control over my work schedule, I delivered pre-processed nuggets of knowledge in front of a crowd and doled out above-average grades upon their absorption. The teaching that formed the central activity of my professional life seemed nothing like the lively and collaborative pursuit of ideas that had enchanted me as a student. I still lived the life of the mind, but it tumbled along quietly in the smallish corner of my existence where I worked and collaborated as a scholar. My students saw little of it. As a student myself, I had learned habits of mind, a delight in certain passages, a sense of what a good question was, an instinct toward the crucial thing in a book or a poem. I had walked certain ways of reading, thinking, and feeling with my teachers, and had imitated them at close quarters. They knew who I was, I knew who they were. This closeness helped them to communicate appropriate encouragement and discouragement. What were my students learning from me? Not much, I had to conclude, and not often. Not because I didn't care or try, but because the institutional arrangements and baseline expectations made the sort of learning I cared about next to impossible. It was a rare student who chose to break through the culture of anonymity to seek out person-to-person collaboration and guidance. I brought my simmering discontent to the church's plentiful resources for self-examination and personal growth: prayer and the sacraments, supplemented by retreats, spiritual direction, and Catholic psychotherapy. It took some years to realize that what I had undertaken as a new and curious hobby, practicing a religion, might have the power to recast my troubles with my work and what I felt was the pointlessness of my life. I learned about the process Catholics call discerning a vocation, in which, through prayer and silence, one waits for God to expose one's deepest motivations and so to clarify the shape of one's life. Never short on self-esteem, I was sure that God would want me to do something quite unusual, and that he would not subject me to the same sacrifices as ordinary believers and discerners. I figured I could live in a poor neighborhood as a sort of Catholic anarchist, teaching Greek and Latin out of my living room to the locals. I could marry someone like-minded and raise anarchist children who would help to build a community with the neighbors. When I asked myself where my income would come from, I hit a wall. Who would support such a life? But what else would I do? Remarkable as were the experiments in living I witnessed in my travels, none seemed right for me. As the years of discontent stretched on, my discomfort grew unbearable. I began to discern religious life, the life of a nun or a sister, trying to face the painful prospect of lifetime celibacy and childlessness. I went first to visit a community of nuns in Switzerland, newly founded in order to promote intellectual life for women in the church. It was perfect on paper. Excellent theology, beautiful liturgies, and an exotic, to me, location. Every day I spent visiting with them, I was miserable, for reasons I could not see or understand. The one bright spot was an afternoon when, exploring the town on my own, I found the Western Union where the poor immigrants gathered and did business, and something in me relaxed. I left, uneasy and uncertain, and visited other communities instead. The others lacked the papery perfection of the first, and offered no improvement in prospective misery. After I left the final community on my list, I determined that I should join the community in Switzerland and take my future unhappiness by the horns. When I explained my decision to my spiritual director, he firmly advised against the deliberate choice of a miserable existence. His kind advice made me furious. I slammed the door as I left his office and went to Sunday Mass at the church across the street. I knelt in the pew and inwardly raged against my situation. I fumed against the sisters I had met, my felt lack of opportunities, and my apparently unsympathetic spiritual director. My rage burned through the opening hymn and the initial readings. The deacon began to read the gospel, which turned out to be the Beatitudes, the part of the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus proclaims the blessed happiness of the poor, the weak, the mournful, and the suffering. I suddenly thought of a religious community I had befriended but had scorned as a final destination, Madonna House, poor, humble, unglamorous, and very much lacking in intellectual resources or opportunities. The puzzle pieces of my life fell relentlessly into place. I understood that I could not live a life of the mind and love my neighbors as a hobby. I had had things the wrong way around. I had to love my neighbors and find a mode of intellectual life that expressed that. To do that, I had to put above everything the form of love that goes under the rather cold English name of charity. I burst into tears. The moment of discernment went in like an arrow and stuck. And though I was plagued by perfectly justified concerns, nothing could shake me from the decision to go. I took another year, procrastinating anxiously, to put in my last bit of teaching, to squeeze out a last publication, and to take leave from my job. I sold my car, gave away my furniture, put my books in storage, and said goodbye to my friends, I thought perhaps for good. On the one hand, once it was all done, I was more relaxed and happier than I had been in years. On the other, a certain terror gripped me. Moving into the community felt like casting myself off in the deep water without a life raft. During the 3 years I spent in the Canadian community, a good reader's library and a handful of fascinating conversations were all the intellectual life I had, despite the occasional care package from academic friends, stuffed with issues of The New Yorker and photocopied philosophy articles. All that was permitted to me was a full, ordinary human life. Work, service, friendship, leisured time in nature, conflict, frustration, and suffering, swimming, crafts, singing in the choir, and radiant, lovingly prepared liturgical celebrations. In the simplified environment of the community, where no one made money and there was no social ladder to climb, the little human things pushed to the forefront of my awareness. Cleaning or organizing, a walk in the woods, pasting autumn leaves onto cards, even emptying a waste basket, all became luminous. With an ordered schedule, instead of an anxiety-driven slurry of work and entertainment, work could be peaceful and free time spontaneous. With simple necessities provided for, we invented the rest. One true Canadian made a Zamboni from scratch for the ice rink in the marsh, using a pot over a fire for melting snow, a hose, and two perforated pipes with cloth attached to smooth the ice. One of the potters sought paintbrushes with a certain soft texture, and so for a time we gathered squirrels that had been killed on the road for their tails. It is perhaps a cliché to say that our humanity is displayed best and enjoyed most when faced with serious limitations, but it is true for all that. Without distractions, we notice what is around us. Without rewards, living.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.